knowledge of
causes B. But you might not have the knowledge of how these things are working. See, if that becomes your own contribution to knowledge. And if you look at publications in psychology knowledge today, that's the type of things you see. It's not likely they're going to publish in Journal of Applied Psychology. It's not likely you're going to publish in Journal of Personality and Social Psychology. It's not likely you're going to publish in Frontiers in Psychology. It's not likely you're going to publish in top psychological bulletin, psychological science, and name them, if you are not building this kind of strong models. And that's actually what it is. You are working in the clinic and you realize that people are not turning in for whatever. They are not following their medication for some of hearing drugs, rehabilitation. You feel that the factor A, one major factor that causes it, maybe we can say family background or maybe family support. Those who have support, who are supported by families, tend to adhere to medication. It's a good one. But what is actually that family support doing that makes the individual to adhere to medication? That's actually what the world wants to know. That's what science wants to know. This support system, what is it doing? Can it should be producing certain patterns of effect that will culminate into reduction or adherence to medication? So maybe the support system gives confidence. Maybe the support system improving the person's self-efficacy. So that's the type of thing you should be testing. What we usually see ourselves doing, as I say, is looking at maybe, and when you do correlation, if you go to the field and generate data, you can always find an outcome, can always find a result. But does that result make any meaning? If you Google something like the spurious correlation, we are going to see that as soon as we decide to look at traffic jam and let's say what is there that may not be connected to maybe traffic situation in Nairobi, maybe the amount of beer taking a day, you can decide to correlate it. And you may run the correlation and realize that the amount of beer taking a day is correlating strongly with traffic. The more traffic, the more beer. But does that make meaning? It may not make meaning. In short, I have one or two spurious correlations here that will give an example of what I want to say. For example, they had a very perfect correlation. For example, I'll give you an example here. So don't have a PowerPoint. For example, this is real data. This is real data, it's not fictitious data. In the US, they correlated the worldwide non-commercial space launches with sociological doctrines and within the US. You can see this pattern. This is almost a perfect relationship. It should be up to 0.98, 0.9 or 7. You can see it's almost 1. For those of you who you understand when I talk about 1, correlation of 1 means perfect relationship. 98 means it's very close to perfect relationship. You can see the pattern. So they just correlated our families. There's also another correlation that was so surprising. They also correlated and realized that head of Miss America correlated strongly with murder by steel, hot pepper, and hot objects in the United States. So what it means is that once we are, if the age of Miss America is 30 years, that year the number of deaths through this age will be high. If you reduce it to 25 years, the murder number of deaths by these methods will also reduce. But is it actually the age of Miss America that is causing this? Is it? But that's what you see most studies. And because of that, we cannot continue to do this type of studies. You must know the mechanism involved, not just running correlations. We want to see our graduate students to just to go to the field, look at the variables, the whatever they feel that is there, and pick the variables, and go to the field and generate that, and then graduate with a degree, even up to doctorate degree. So if you continue to do that kind of studies, you are not going to publish them in good journals. And it's just issue of design. It has nothing to do with whatever. If good data, quality data, we didn't say the data was good. Good data connected it in also a very clear way. But because we are not speaking to science. Because some of these things, when you want to do science, they must be based on theories. That is the background to those issues leading to certain things. But beyond the background, what you do, you need to look at where we stop in science and begin to develop new areas that no one has talked about. So that's it. One challenge with this type of correlation is
is that there may be also what we call the issue of reversal or what endogeneity for some of you in economics. Because one may cause the other one, another one may also cause the other one. But if you are looking at causation, you must establish that independent variable causes dependent variable. But dependent variable can never cause independent variable. If you don't want to establish it in your research, then you are not doing science. Some of us who publish in top journals, look, you know, the first thing they ask you is, are you sure that it is this that causes this? Then begin to question your design. Are you sure really that it is this that causes this? And there are many ways of establishing that. I'll give you a typical example, maybe to just draw down what I'm going to say. Now, one of the major studies in this economics, political science, a very well cited study, I think there are about almost 1,000 citations today. This Dollar and colleague, World Bank economists were looking at the, what do you call it, number of women in parliament and corruption. And do you know what they found? They found across the world, well-designed study in their own way. They found that the more we have women in parliament, the less the country will be corrupt. And they published it in a very, very big journal. They attracted the world interest. More women in parliament, less corruption. And what does that signify? For policy, we are saying, if you want to reduce corruption in countries like Kenya, Nigeria, and other notorious countries that are really corrupt, what to do is to make sure that you have a policy of bringing more women in parliament. But would that actually is the case? It may not. The reversal may be the case. It may be that number of is corruption that is leading to more women in parliament, rather than more women in parliament leading to less corruption. Because maybe less corrupt countries may have opportunities for women to be in parliament. You understand? Because in high corrupt countries, men will usually hijack the resources. And they use this supposed to make sure that you have. So what it means in the high corrupt countries, you are going to have less women in parliament. So it's not actually the number of women in parliament that is producing the outcome, that is reducing the corruption. But rather the corruption that is reducing the number of women in parliament. Do you understand what I mean?
Yeah.
So that's actually the challenge. They could not establish that actually that is corruption that led to less, whatever, it's number of women in parliament that led to less. They are not the only people that do that kind of work, do that kind of research. People must do a whole thing. I'll give you my own typical example. I did a study in 2012 with two Poles, two guys from Poland and one from United States. We started the study, wanted to have a global cross-cultural study, but that started in Nigeria first. When I finished the study, number of children and marital satisfaction. Because across the world, once people is assumed that number of children reduces satisfaction in marriage. That's what is known in the Western world. But what if we also test it in developing countries? And I started that study. And we found out that more number of children led to satisfaction, marital satisfaction in Africa, in Nigeria. And that was really interesting. Maybe we finished this study, we didn't wait to continue the other cross-cultural study. We went ahead to try to complete that study. And it was published in the Evolution of Human Behavior. And more satisfaction, more children, more satisfaction. But can you really say that it's actually the number of children that produces the satisfaction? It may not. The reverse may be the case. It may be that it's the number of children that, you know, is the marital satisfaction that producing the number of children. Am I right?
Yes.
It's true. And don't tell me that we didn't do a good research. We did a very solid research. Solid control, control for cost. What you may be asking may be white. But we control for white in the analysis. Because it's assumed that people, if you have more children, may demand so much from you and in terms of resources, and because of that resource, you may become dissatisfied with your marriage and with your partner. So we assume that those who are rich may not influence them so much as it's influencing them. So we actually included that in analysis and still got a very strong support for number of children and marital satisfaction. So, but I'm saying that it may be the marital section that actually produce more children. Because when people are happy with their marriage, the chances they are going to stay with their spouses is high. Am I right? Yeah. And because they stay with their spouses more often, the chance that they're going to do something will also be high. And the chances after doing something that they also produce children are also high. Am I right? So if you see the mechanism, it may even be more compelling, theoretically. So why do you not know that? So what it means is that we needed to do something more. We needed to do some research that will be able to tell us the patterns, why this number of children is leading. Because what we did was just to use theories to explain it. That in part of the Africa, white people require children to support them, especially when they have weak social security systems, that children become the source of happiness. That's a rise, but it's not a real science in terms of testing. So what we did was to recently we replicated that study in 33 countries. And we found no relationship. Zero relationship. It was scattered across 33 countries. It was published in 2017 in Frontiers in Psychology. And we're about 30-something or 40-something in that project. So we replicated that study again and found no result. What it means is that it may not actually be the number of children that did it to some natural disadvantage. It means something else. I think we have rested that part of research for now. So others need to think through. So there's no need thinking about number of children in marital satisfaction. Whatever, because it doesn't make sense. So we need to look for other possible explanations. That's actually what it is. So what am I now proposing is that we may begin to look at scholars that may help. There are two ways of dealing with these issues. Either you do deal with it through statistics, or you deal with it through designs. For statistical purposes, you can run some stronger analysis that may give you an opportunity of knowing if you can actually be sure. If you actually be sure that it's actually A that leads to B. So from statistical point of view, what do you do? You can do what we call control. Am I right?
That's right.
You can do something like control. Or, and when we talk about control, you can do some, have you done something like regression analysis? Those of you who use this regression analysis, you can do simple control the same of the variables that you feel that may be influencing the outcome. So that once you control them, people can begin to trust that. It's only the factor you isolated that is causing the outcome. Actually, that's why that paper in number of children that such was published. If we did not control for some of these variables, they would have published that study because it's so simplistic. Another way of doing that through statistics is to do something like what we call path analysis, mediation analysis, structural equation models. In this way, we are building a stronger design, a stronger statistical model that will enable you to explain how these relationships are going on. You can collect data on the independent variable, collect data on possible mediators, then collect data on the dependent variable. So you can now run a chain of analysis to see how this number of children is leading to marital satisfaction. You can test other intervening variables in one model, in statistical. You can do that. If you do that, you'll be speaking to science. And chance of publishing this kind of papers are high. So that's the type of thing. And it's so easy, so simple these days to do. You just need to get in. His model, you can use SPSS and use the HIS. HIS has developed a lot of models that are very simple. What you just do is to keep this data in. And that's the computer, please test mediation for me. I want to see how these things are working. And it will come out beautifully and be able to see if actually there are some underlying variables. You can also do motivation analysis, of course, to see if there are other variables that are actually contributing to the patterns of the relationships. This from the statistical point of view. You can also do the kind of design. I'm sure you are following what I'm doing. Yeah. Are you following me? I'm just trying to just give kind of a pep talk in 2-3 minutes. Yeah. I know that one time if we have opportunity of coming to maybe to do a detailed work, we'll be able to do it there. You can also do some, as I said, you can do it, approach it in two ways, either statistically or through design. And design is the best approach. Because it's not after you have finished your study, you start battling on the type of statistics to use. The best is to go through design first. And in a design way, we all know that experimental designs are the best. That's the best approach to establishing causality. You manipulate, you set two groups, control, whatever, any type of design that you are sure. You are introducing an intervention in one group and you are not introducing intervention in another group. Anything that comes out that could be comfortably attributed to the manipulation you are doing, basically. But as you can understand, especially some, most of whom work in the field, it's not likely that the type of study that you do will be amenable to experiments. It's not likely. So meaning that that type of experimentation may not be so feasible. So if it's not, you can also do something. You can plan a longitudinal design. A longitudinal designs. Because longitudinal design will help to see patterns of events and relationships over time. And if you'll be able to see how these things are working over time, it's most likely by establishing causality. It's most likely establishing causality. In short, most studies to very top journals, they find it difficult to publish just a correlation study. You need some element of longitudinal designs. Or you have, if you see something like Journal of Applied Psychology, Journal of Personality and Social Psychology, what you usually see there publish are mixed designs. They will do experiments, they will do a survey, correlational, they will go to the field and test it, they also try longitudinal design in one. They can have study one, study two, study three, to be sure that what they are actually claiming is correct. Because why science, why they don't publish weak studies in top journals is that they don't want to believe what you are saying. They don't want to claim about type one or type two errors. They don't want to, they want to be sure that this method you have used was actually good enough, tight to produce the outcome so that we follow. Because what it means in science is that we are telling them, you are the first that did this study and you led to this, so we should. Every intervention, everything we are doing should be based on whatever you find. That's why in top journals, they will publish those things. Because they need you to prove younger is never out, according to those in law, that actually that A causes B. So that's actually why some of these things are important. Maybe if you cannot do anything, you can do a mixed method research. Mixed method may help you. You can test the independent variables, effect on independent variable. But you may need to introduce, maybe you do that quantitatively. You may need a kind of an explanation that you can use qualitative approach to see these underlying variables. Why is it happening the way it's happening? Unfortunately for us in Africa, most African psychologists descend from the American model, especially in Nigeria, in such a way that it's quantitative. It's more quantitative, so quantitative. But the British model, they have a lot of qualitative in there. So, but if it's mixed, I think it's better. Because just speaking that this causes this doesn't work all the time. So I think that's actually what I feel. I'll give you a simple example. I did a study, it was a sponsored study by DFID and PASGA.
Yes.
We did a study on the decentralization project in Africa. And I did one study with my colleagues, one in political science, the other one in communication studies. And what we are trying to look at is how democracy leads to service delivery. And the fact that it's new, in our study, in the first line of analysis, regressional analysis, we realized that democracy was correlating with service delivery, but in the opposite direction. Those who are in less democratic settings were perceiving the service delivery of their government as hard. Then we said, no, this why? What is happening? Then we had to use another method, qualitative method, to ask the participant, why are you feeling that way? What is happening? We realized that in democratic settings, there's a lot of promises, expectations, and in this local council couldn't meet the expectations of the people. So they felt dissatisfied. Because they promised a whole lot of things more than their budget and they couldn't meet all. So because of that, they got frustrated and started rating them low. But in appointed councils, the expectations were low and so blah blah. That was it. So I think I'm true. This is just a kind of the type of things I would do and I feel that we should be doing. So if any of you are coming to Suka to do your doctorate, that's what we're battling for a year or two. So if I'm my doctorate student, we work on this for the first 6 months, dealing with getting a model, dealing with getting something that when you see it, you have at least face validity. You at least, even if you didn't get it, at least it will have face validity. So one more thing, like the last study I did, I presented it the last 2 months in Washington. We are trying to get it to Journal of Applied Psychology now. Try to study on the very last, and we want to try ourselves with Journal of Applied Psychology, which is number one in my area. So what did I do? I looked at work engagement and work family conflict. Wanted to know the dark side of engagement. Everybody feels that work engagement is positive, but we wanted to look at the dark side and see the pattern. Why can work engagement lead to work family interference? interfere with our happiness at all. And we're looking at two possible mechanisms. One is behavioral, the other one is cognitive. The behavioral has been tested worse in a study. We are feeling that those who get work again tend to go the extra mile. That's the exhibit citizenship behavior, CD more. And because it's been citizenship behavior, they deplete the energy so much at work. When they go home, they are left with less energy to face family responsibility because of that experience of family conflict. We also felt that it could come from the cognitive side. Those who get so much engaged at work, when they return home, they continue to ruminate about work. And because they ruminate about work, they continue to further deplete the energy required at work. And we could find out that model was tested and proved. But we didn't stop at that. We also feel that there could be some mechanism that could help someone. There's some boundary conditions. Those who get work engaged, but they have family support at home, the chances that they may not express work family conflict is high, irrespective of how they get there. Also at work, those who get engaged, but they could craft their jobs a bit. When I mean job crafting, maybe reorganizing their job in a way that makes it a bit flexible for them. It may not deplete their energy so much, so they may not express work family conflict. That's the type of robust model that we have. The first line review for now is positive. Everybody felt we have done something good, but we are hoping that in the next couple of months, some of you will be reading that kind of study in Nigeria. That journal of applied or whatever. So that's the type of thing I feel we should be trying ourselves. I'm sorry to take your time.
That's very
okay, thanks. All right.